Distinguished Speaker Mr. S. Gurumurthy, Professor R. Vaidyanathan, faculty colleagues, student friends from SASTRA as well as other institutions who have come here to participate in Daksh, a very good evening to all of you. I am extremely happy to lay down the context again for the Daksh Power Talk, which is now, thanks to an initiative that the university has taken, is referred to as the second Cho Ramaswamy Memorial Lecture. And most of you in the audience would have listened to the first lecture delivered by Dr. Vivek Debroy last year. But the topic that we have chosen for the second Cho Ramaswamy Memorial Lecture is in continuation with the Daksh Power Talk series topics that we have had so far, with the central theme being 4.0, of which you have heard Business 4.0, Entrepreneurship 4.0, Womanhood 4.0, and in the last session, Bhakti 4.0. The fifth in that series is World 4.0 and the role of India in that. And it is so appropriate that we have chosen this topic for the second Cho Ramaswamy Memorial Lecture, because I strongly believe that the understanding of World 4.0 means the understanding of India, and that it cannot be separated. And that is why I never ventured to explain to the speaker on what should be spoken, because I never do that in the case of Mr. S. Gurumurthy. But the growing glamour of this terminology 4.0, since Professor R. Vaidyanathan is here, I'll give credit to him, but I will anyway borrow his quote, that it has created, you know, terminological terrorism. The world 4.0 means everybody thinks, no, it is so scary, something is going to hit us. But I'm sure both of us share the feeling that unless we understand India in the way that it has to be understood, it is extremely difficult to understand the world. And whatever versions of the world it may be, world 1.0, 2.0, 3.0, requires a better understanding of India 1.0, 2.0, 3.0. And for many those who have dominated the public discourse on the understanding of India, they have understood, or maybe many times ended up misunderstanding the world, because their understanding of India missed certain fundamental thought processes. So it became imperative that to understand the world, Indians must first understand India better. And I could immediately relate to the legendary Cho Ramaswamy, who, in the limited interaction that I've had with him, I don't recall him being a frequent visitor to any of the foreign countries. But sitting in India, I think, that's my personal opinion, he understood the world better and engaged in public intellectual discourse. And the reason for that is that he understood India in the manner that it has to be understood. The way in which there has been distortion in this understanding has intellectually disconnected the intelligentsia from maybe the civilizational asset of the country, the economic history of the country, the cultural history of the country, the political history of the country, as a result of which today's geopolitics is becoming a very dizzy cocktail, that if we need to redefine the geopolitical discourse, India should take a lead in ensuring that this discourse shapes the contours of the future understanding of not only India, but also in the process the world. And that is why, ladies and gentlemen, I felt that Mr. S. Gurumurthy, who has extensively researched on the idea of India, the economics of India, the culture of India, the polity of India, the jurisprudence of India, the corporate ink of India, all of this so deeply, and articulated better as an Indian's perspective for the world's understanding. And that's the main reason why I thought he will be the best speaker to deliver this talk on the topic World 4.0, the role of emerging India. The reason is that many changes have happened in the global history. Many forms of economies have come and gone. Many forms of political structure have come and gone. Many forms of civilizational continuum have come and gone. But one thing that is always assured with endured longevity is the idea of India. And that idea of India today is presented with a vacuum of thought which I feel should be filled by the Indian thought process, because if that gets filled, not only will the understanding of India get better, but also the global direction in which the world is going to move will also be in the right direction. So with this very brief background, ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and welcome Shri S. Gurumurthy for the second Cho Ramaswamy Memorial Lecture. And I will be very brief, and that's why I am ending my welcome address with this very brief background, and request Mr. S. Gurumurthy to deliver the lecture. Over to you, sir.
My good friend, Dr. Vaidya Subramaniam, the Dean of this institution, who briefly introduced the topic on which I am supposed to share my thoughts with you now, Dr. Badrinath, and the Chancellor of this institution, who has, in my opinion, built an institution which has maintained very high value system, which is becoming something of a rare. And so I always consider it a privilege and even an obligation to come and talk whenever invitation comes from Mr. Sethuraman. And my good friend, Mr. Vaidyanathan, who, having delivered a lecture in the morning, I told him take leave and rest, but he has chosen to suffer this lecture for an hour. And Mr. Srinivasan, a friend of mine who is sitting here, and faculty members, students. See, this topic I came to know only this morning when I looked at the invitation that I am supposed to talk about World 4.0 and India's role or rising role in a world. Of course, you can interpret the World 4.0 in your own way. A technologist will interpret it in a particular way, a historian will interpret it in a particular way, an economist will interpret it in a particular way, an educationist may interpret it in a different way. But this sectional understanding of the world has to be comprehensively integrated and presented as one module. That's what I will attempt to do. Because of the experience which I had undergone in my 35 years of intense pursuit of knowledge, which is never complete. You are always a student when you decide to pursue knowledge. So, in this, as a chartered accountant, as a person who had come in contact intensely with business, finance, trade, commerce, and then into economics, and because of the fact that I got interested in public affairs, that I came in contact with a powerful media group, the Indian Express, through which I began carrying on a huge campaign against corruption and landed in jail and became popular and became a journalist. You know, all these are accidents provided by life, a coherent set of accidents, which made me understand diverse aspects of life, public and private, social, political, economic, cultural, from a helicopter view. The more you learn, the more subjects you learn, the more people you come in contact with, the more problems you face, the more pain you undergo, that elevates you to a higher level of understanding the world. It is from this perspective I will try to present World 4.0. But you can always try and talk about the world, but has it any relevance to India? Has India any relevance to the world? Unless we understand this, we will not be able to mesh India and the world. And great brains have thought about India, because we have petty little brains in India today, masquerading as intellectuals, as media persons, as writers, or as leaders, or as academicians. Unless you know how great minds have looked at India, you will not be able to mesh what is World 4.0 and India. And I would like to begin where normally people would like to end. And I am going to refer to two great minds, two greatest historians of the last century, who have not been surpassed even in this century so far. Arnold Toynbee, a British historian, and Will Durance, an American historian. Toynbee lived from 1889 to 1975, and almost around that time Will Durant lived, 1885 to 1981. I am going to read out what is their quote about what the world is and where does India fit in. It is already becoming clear that a chapter which had a Western beginning will have to have an Indian ending. Mark these words. A chapter which had a Western beginning. Chapter means the chapter of the history of the world. Which had a Western beginning will have to have an Indian ending. Mark the next part of the sentence. If it is not to end in self-destruction of the human race. A huge proposition. A huge statement. That if the world is to be saved from destruction, the Western world will have to have an Indian ending, otherwise the world will end. Have you ever heard this kind of statement from any Indian intellectual, academician, historian, political leader? And at this supremely dangerous moment in human history, the only way of salvation is the ancient Hindu way. In fact, the word Hindu itself makes us feel terrified that this is a narrow idea, this is a communal idea, this is an anti-modern idea. But the world doesn't understand it this way. It's an ancient idea. Politics may have reduced its meaning and may have made it a trivial idea. But intellectuals, philosophers, who are historians, they understand it differently. Your academic curriculum teaches you things which trivializes the greatest of ideas into smallest of things. But we have to, as people who think, who want to be intellectual, who want to understand things, moving away from contemporary limitations which are imposed by politics, modernity and many other things which have a transient existence, we have to move away to understand the true meaning of this. At this supremely dangerous moment in human history, the only way of salvation is the ancient Hindu way. Here we have the attitude and spirit that can make it possible for the human race to grow together into a single family. You have no other thought which can make the world grow into a single family. You know why? You may have diverse ideas, you may have diverse gods, you may have diverse ways of worship, you may have diverse way of eating food. But all of us know one thing, with all this diversity, only we have to live. If we look at the diversity and not look at the commonality, all of us will be fighting and killing each other. This is the greatest gift that this ancient civilization gave to the world, that the human beings will always have differences. Brother and brother will have difference, father and son will have difference, husband and wife will have difference. But all of us have to live together. This idea has been generated in this country, that we knew how to live with the differences. Erasing the differences is impossible. That is why India never attempted unity, it always attempted harmony. Harmony is living with differences. Unity means erasing differences. All those civilizations, religions which wanted to eliminate differences ended up killing and maiming and destroying millions and millions of people, about which I will tell you in the course of my speech. This is Arnold Toynbee, who lived up to 1975. Then Will Durant. Any of you have heard about Will Durant? He wrote a book, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Will Durant is the person who wrote a book, A Case for India. This book was written at the instance of Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi wanted Will Durant to speak of how India was destroyed by the British rule and the entire prosperity of Britain was traced by Will Durant to the amount of wealth they stashed away from India, and that is the book called A Case for India. None of us will read this. Your textbooks will not be this kind of textbooks prescribed for you. You have to go out of your curriculum to steal knowledge, otherwise you don't understand about India. Will Durant writes this. It is true that even across Himalayan barrier, India has sent to us such unquestionable gifts as grammar and logic, philosophy and fables, hypnotism and chess. Many people do not know chess originated in India. And above all, numerals and our decimal system. This he talks about the material gifts to the world. But he now says, but these are not the essence of our spirit. They are trifles as compared to what we may learn from her in future. This is about the past. What we can learn from India in future is what he is going to say. Perhaps in return for the conquest, arrogance and spoliation which we have given to India. This is what he says. Perhaps in return for conquest, we conquered India. We were arrogant to India. We spoliated India. India will teach us the tolerance and the gentleness of mature mind the quiet content of the unacquisitive calm and the calm understanding of the spirit and a unifying, a pacifying love for all living beings. This is the most important thing. In Vedas there is a phrase, tacham jorabrini mahe gatum yajnaya gatum yajnapataye devehi swastirastunah swastir manushebhyah urjam jigadibedasham sanno astu dipate sanchatushpate. You know what does that mean? I pray for all living beings, whether they walk on four legs or two legs. For all living beings, no other civilization had any prayer of this kind, because we looked at the world from a helicopter perspective, from the Himalayas. So now, why I made this point, which normally anyone will make at the end, is to make you understand what is the relationship between India and the world, and how great minds look at India as the salvation for the world. You will never be taught this. You will never know this. The world tells you this. How the world perceives you and how you perceive the world constitutes the conflict between the Indian mind, Indian way of doing things, and what the world needs and expects from you. So there is a correlation between India and the world. India has a message to give to the world, not in a textbook form, in a living form. You cannot learn character, integrity, behavior from libraries. You have to see living examples. So India has to give a living message. And that is why the world 4.0 has an intimate nexus with India. And I divide the world 4.0 like this. The world had four stages in the last 2500 years to reach this present state. One is conquest by war. They decided to conquer the whole world by war. When I say world, it is the Euro world. It is the Euro world which became the world. So, it is conquest by war. Rome and Greek devastated the world. As Swami Vivekananda said, the earth trembled at the name of the Greek army. The Roman eagle floated over everything in the world. This is what Swami Vivekananda says in the first of his lectures in the Colombo to Almora. He landed in Colombo from Almora and his first lecture was this. Then conquest by religion. They tried to conquer the whole world by religion, and they have conquered a very large part of the world. They first conquered Europe in the first millennium. In the second millennium, they conquered the Americas and Africas. So the only spot left is Africa. So the Pope said in 1999, we have conquered all the continents other than Asia, and we have to plant the cross on Asia now. It is this state, with this statement he came to India. Conquest by religion. Third, conquest by colonialism, commerce, ideology. Many people do not even know what is ideology, but I will tell you later. You, all of you know colonialism, about which Will Durant wrote that book, how by colonialism they devastated India. They ruled the whole world. Churchill said, sun doesn't set in our empire, it always shines, because everywhere around the world they had only British territory, controlled, conquered by them. The last stage is conquest by modernity. All of you think modernity means language, the dress, these classrooms, technology. Modernity is something different. When I tell you about that modernity, you will all be shaken what that modernity is. I will reserve it later. But that is a challenge which you are facing as to how to handle the modern world. India is in a position to handle the modern world today, and it has to handle the modern world in the interest of the world itself. Because as Will Durant and all Toynbee said, India has this responsibility to the world. And it is in this perspective we have to understand what is India's responsibility to the world 4.0. The world 4.0 is the modern world. And we have to understand what is modern world to handle the problems of the modern world. And now let us look at what is India 1, 2, 3, 4. India 1 was the great India. Many of us do not even know we were great at one point in time. Many people will think we built great big temples and so we were great. Yes, we did build good temples. We had literature, we had art, we had music, we had spiritualism, we had Vedas, the Upanishad, the Tirukkural. We were intellectual giants. As Swami Vivekananda said, when the whole world had painted itself in blue, we were a great civilization. But that is not just the greatness of India. You know, we were always told that India was great in every respect. But you know, India was a self-denying civilization. It never understood what was prosperity. India worshipped poverty. We wanted to be a poor country, we didn't want to be a rich country, and because of that we didn't have the ambition to achieve economic prosperity. And we were told, we were taught, we were convinced. And because of that in 1978, one of the well-known economists of India, he was asked, he was the advisor to the government of India, he was asked, why is it that all countries are growing faster? We are following the same socialist policy which Russia is following, Yugoslavia is following, Warsaw countries are following. We are following the same socialist policies. Why are we not growing faster? We are going slow. To which that economist replied, what can we do? Whatever policies we can follow, we follow, we can have only the Hindu rate of growth. As if the entire Hindu civilization is incapable of performing. And this became a global word. Robert McNamara took this one. Robert McNamara was the president of the World Bank. He took this one remark and addressed the world between 1978. When Professor Rajkrishna made this statement, and in 3 years from 1979 to 1982, Robert McNamara must have addressed at least half a dozen world conferences in which he said, India is one country which will never grow, which will always be in poverty. I beg for aid from you for the poor of India. This was the brand of India at that time. Because of our own economists, our own leaders, our own media, our own intellectuals, our own academics, our own educational institutions, presenting India as an important nation in economic issues. We never even attempted to question whether what is being said about us is correct or not. A research was instituted by the General Agreement on Trade and Tariff. Have you ever heard General Agreement on Trade and Tariff? GATT Agreement. GATT Agreement was the precursor to the WTO. WTO was World Trade Organization instituted in 1995. But the General Agreement on Trade and Tariff was instituted in 1950. The GATT wanted to know how the world economy had moved from 1750 to 1900, 150 years. They did a study, and the study was done by a Belgian economist, a great name in economic history, by name Paul Bayrock. Paul Mayrock set out his figures as to what the world was in 1750. He said in 1750, the two leading economic engines of the world were China with 34% of world GDP, India was next with almost 25% of world GDP, both of them put together almost 60% of world GDP in 1750. And the share of India, share of America and England put together, anyone else knows here? 2%. And in 1900, the picture changes completely. China and India crashed to 8% from 59%. China 6.8%, 6.2%. India 1.8%. In this period, US and America walked from 2% to 41%. So Paul Byron said it is in this period the poor became rich and rich became poor. This shook the world. French historians wrote books. Let us admit that India and China had much better standard of living than us in the 16th and 17th and 18th centuries. And our prosperity is a recent prosperity. The West could not take it. So in 1983, the OECD organizations, have you heard of OECD? Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. This is a network of 24 countries. They instituted a research, Development Studies Institute under Angus Madison, the greatest economic historian ever. And Angus Madison did research for 18 years and he came out with his book, World Economic History, A Millennial Perspective, in the year 2001. Because all this is available on the net, it is no secret. You can go today evening, check all these. This entire report of Angus Madison is available on the net. But before he started the research, Angus Madison said, what Paul Byrock said cannot be true. But anyhow, I will do the research. He came out to the research not for 150 years. He came out to the research showing study for 2000 years. From the first year of the Common Era to 2001. And in the first year of the Common Era, he said India was leading the world with 34% of world GDP. China number 2. After 10 centuries, India was still leading with 28%. 11th century, India was leading, China number 2. 12th, India still number 1, China number 2. 13th, the same position. 14th, the same position. 15th, India and China equal. 16th, China overtakes India. 17th century, India overtakes China. 19th century, both were overtaken by others. Any of you know this? You can understand how minimal is our knowledge about our country. A country which has to play a role, which the world says you are going to play a role, we know nothing about. So, the great India was not only an India in terms of architecture, literature, philosophy, spiritualism, it was also in economics. In fact, when India began rising in 2005, 2004, 5 onwards, British historians began writing, it is not a rags to riches story. It is an empire which was occupying a high position, had slipped a little, it is coming back to acquire its position. This was the article written in the Guardian newspaper on the 60th anniversary of India's freedom. I don't think any such article would ever be written in India. Because our knowledge base is so minimal. Our confidence is so little about our country. That we can never think that our country was great in the past. Even if you talk about the greatness, you are great in music, you are great in arts, you are great in sculpture, you are great. But you did not do anything great like America did. This is how your mindset is. So, a great India. This was India 1. India 2, a conquered India. An India which was conquered and devastated by the invaders for the last 1,000 years. Why was India conquered and devastated? I need not have to tell you much to except to advise you to read. Couple of books. You need not have to read more books. One book is The History of India, A History of Kerala by Padmanabh Menon, in which he says why India was defeated. India was defeated because of its war models. You will never attack a person in the night, you will never attack a person who has dropped his arms, you will never attack a person without giving notice. You will never commence a war without beating the drum, you will never proceed with the war after the sun is set, you will never begin the war after the sun rises. These were our rules. The barbarians who attacked had no rules. They will attack you anytime. These rules, which were observed in the days of Mahabharata, were continued in Kerala in the 16th and 17th century, according to Padmanabh Menon. So when a superior civilization is attacked by a barbaric civilization, the superior civilization always loses, according to Arnold Toynbee himself. That is why we lost. We became a conquered country. This conquest became colonial. It became intellectual. We lost our independence of mind. We began celebrating the conquerors. In fact, we thought the conquerors have come to save us. This is how books were written. This is how lectures were given. This is how classes were held. Universities were instituted. Now, we have a confused India. Because of all this, there is confusion. We don't even know what is our country. In fact, the IIT Bombay had invited me to a lecture like you have invited me now in the year 2010. In that lecture, some of the points which I mentioned to you just now, I mentioned because the person who spoke ahead of me was a very big name, an industrialist by name, Adi Godrej. He mentioned specifically the Hindu rate of growth and said we never knew what prosperity was. We began to understand what is prosperity only after globalization came, liberalization came. We had more cars, more scooters, more this, more that. And so Indians came out of the sense of poverty in economics only when globalization came into being. And after he delivered that lecture, which is one of the best lectures delivered in English. You know, if you deliver a lecture in English, you are accepted as an intellectual. And a person speaking in English is supposed to be speaking the truth also. See the kind of loss of independence you have in your mind. So I was to speak next. He was celebrated. The students were jumping and clapping at the way India was humiliated. I was to speak next. Then I mentioned all these points. The very audience which celebrated the earlier speaker began celebrating me and they all surrounded me. Sir, please take a course for us. This institution will not teach us these things. We want to know about our country. And they made me the visiting professor to IIT to teach these subjects for which there is no textbook. There is no classroom. There is no space in the media. There is no political leader aware of this. So they made me visiting 4 years. I took classes in IIT Bombay in the management faculty. I told them only one thing. Please don't go for campus interview. I want you to set up your own business. I told them I went to Tirupur, I went to Namakkal, I went to Karur, I went to Ludhiana, I went to Batala, I went to Rajkot, I went to Morbi. And I found in all these places, people do who do business, who perform well in industry, are people who are educated up to 8th, 10th, 9th standard, and they employ all these MBA graduates. If you want, you can go and see Tirupur today. In Tirupur there are, and I can even give you the name of the book which mentions this fact, Fraternal Capital by Dr. Chari. He is from Boston Consulting. He was asked to study Tirupur because Tirupur was being mentioned all over the world as one of the biggest knitwear center, export centers of India. But when the foreigners tried to find out where Tirupur was not in the All India map. At the time there was no Google. Now you can find out even a little village, my house can be located in Google. It was not so at that time. So they tried to find and they found that there is a small place called Tirupur by the side of Coimbatore, which has just one flight per week in those days. And a very small road. How is it that place is performing so well? No infrastructure. You all talk about infrastructure today. Nothing. So they, Boston Consulting, sent a Tamil knowing research scholar by name Chari. He wrote that book in which he came out with an astounding finding. It's not astounding for us, it is astounding for them. At least it is not astounding for me. Out of the 300 odd exporters at that time, 69% were educated less than 10th standard. Only 7% were graduates. They were negotiating at the global level for business. And they were employing lawyers, they were employing chartered accountants, they were employing MBAs. These people were doing that work. You know how they became such entrepreneurs? 30 years back, they were farmers growing cotton. You know that area is full of black soil. On black soil only cotton grows. So they were growing cotton and when they went and delivered cotton, the ginners were making the cotton into spinnable cotton. They said, we can do this also. Why should we deliver cotton to them? Then they began delivering ginned cotton. Then when they delivered the ginned cotton, they found that it is being spun into yarn. We can do this. Why should we go and deliver ginned yarn to them? Then they began delivering yarn to them. Then they found they were weaving and selling the cotton cloth, grey cotton cloth. Then they began manufacturing grey cotton cloth. Then they found some knitters were making bunions and things like that, innerwears. Then they began doing that in 25 years. It is the cotton growing farmers who became knitwear exporters in India. No educational institution, no textile institute achieved this. This is the economics I learned for 10 years I travelled across the country in 1992 onwards. When a different India emerged before me, that is how I began understanding India. So when I explained all this to the IIT Bombay, I was so happy to know. I had stopped teaching year before last because of my mother's demise and I couldn't go afterwards. I went to Indore where I addressed a public meeting when two young men came and touched my feet. Sir, we are now. They had set up an industry in 3 years which was employing according to them 900 people a little away from Indore. They said, sir, we were students and we were your second batch. Now our factory was opened only last month. It is because you told us, otherwise I would never have become an entrepreneur. Education is a barrier to entrepreneurship. And they said one more thing which made me feel so fulfilled. Sir, last year nobody went for campus interview in IIT, what is that? Some Mehta Management. Shailesh Mehta School of Management. From there nobody went for campus interview. Everybody has decided to do business. Slight shift of psychology. Entrepreneurship is adventure. Only a confident society can produce entrepreneurs. The society which our educational institution produces, our intellectuals produces, our public discourse produces is an inferior society. It suffers from serious inferiority complex. No, I can't do it. I put you on the stage, you shiver. Why? You must know everybody is shivering. Why should you shiver? You think everybody else is confident. I am not. I have written an article in the Tughlaq magazine. Now I am the editor. At the time I was writing. I went to Tirupur. Srinivasan was with me. He is no professor. At the time he was not. So when we went there, we went and saw one manufacturer manufacturing a machine which is 1/4 of the size of this hall. It is a machine which stretches the banyan cloth. And when we saw the machine, its finish was like the finish of the cell phone. And he has only 20 employees. He was educated up to 5th standard. And he said, sir, from the beginning of my life, I always wanted to be a machine manufacturer. Whatever that machine is, I was manufacturing machine with clay when he was a young boy. And then he decided to manufacture machine. He used to go to place to place to place. And the machine which was needed for Tirupur, he began manufacturing. And he manufactured it at a cost of 90 lakhs. When the imported machinery was 160 lakhs. And he sold 90 machines in India and exported 100 machines outside India. He did not know one word of English. Sir, I am employing an English educated manager, sir, who was educated up to pre-university. Why I am mentioning is, this is the India we know nothing about. Economic Times will not tell you this, Business Standard will not tell you this, Business Line will not tell you this, government will not tell you this, your classroom will not tell you this. So we started traveling across the country and we produced a book ultimately. Professor Kanagasabhapathi, who was a colleague doing this work, he is now teaching for you. Yes. So we decided to produce a book. And you know, that book reads like a novel. Don't be afraid, it is business models. If you read that book, it is a novel. People who are exporting diamonds for 40,000 crores were educated only up to 5th standard. 5 of the largest diamond exporters in India have not crossed 5th standard. We have now taken over Amsterdam, which is the diamond capital of the world. We are the most trusted people there. The Jews were handling the $25 billion diamond trade market 30 years ago. You know what is our share of the diamond trade market today? 2/3 of the trade Indians have taken over, $16 billion is in the hands of Indians. You know how did this happen? We began importing diamonds, raw diamonds, and cut them and sent it back. Diamond cutting is one of the most difficult job because it's very valuable, it can be stolen, it can be lost. So all these diamonds used to, because Kathiawaris and Jains from Gujarat went for this diamond trade, they brought the diamonds, and through the community linkages they delivered the diamonds, got them polished, cut and polished and exported. This began 25 years ago. At that time there used to be no water. Now there is huge amount of water in Gujarat because of the check dams which have been built during the period of the present Prime Minister. Otherwise the Saurashtra used to suffer for drinking water. So a million people used to go to Surat just for drinking water for 4 months. They used to go with all their cattle because even the cattle needed water. So the entire Surat city became an open air lavatory. So there was a law and order problem. They could not be stopped because a million people used to come. So the, all these English educated people used to abuse, these are all dirty Indians, these people must die, why are they coming here? Media used to write, the politicians have no backbone, they can't stop them, our life is being affected. This used to be the article 25 years ago. But you know, all those people who came there learnt diamond cutting in Surat. Today the entire Saurashtra is the diamond cutting backyard factory of the whole world. 9 out of 10 diamonds are cut in Gujarat. Has anyone made a study of this? So why I am mentioning it is, we are a confused India. We know nothing about our country. But you, the English educated people, are the ones who are going to deal with the world. I told the IIT people, you are high-end educational institution. You are supposed to interface India to the world. You are supposed to tell the Indians about the world. You are supposed to be the bridge between us, the communicators, the ambassadors. But you know nothing about India. That is the world, and this is India. India is rising. On that, no one has any doubt. India is rising in spite of all of us, you must understand. We have done nothing for the rise of India. Particularly the English educated people have done nothing for the rise of India except to abuse India. It's a dirty country, it is a rotten country, it is a corrupt country, it's a useless country. This is the certificate English educated people have been giving for the last 50-60 years, and but still India is rising. Have you read any English newspapers and got respect for India? Tell me, just raise your hand. One person, raise your hand. I have been reading English newspapers for the last 15 years. I have developed huge respect for India. One person, please lift your hand. The English discourse disrespects, demeans, devalues India. But still India is rising. Today it is seen as this, it is seen as that. It is in this context. We have to understand what India can do to the world and what the world can do to India. Now you look at the world. Where does the world start? World today means the West-driven world. There is no other world. Because till about 18th century, Asians were driving the world. But we did not know how to kill others. The most important thing is, the West knew how to kill people. You may be surprised that I say the West kills people. Immediately note this website which I am giving to you. R.J. Rammal's website. The website is known as Demo Site. This website captures people killed in the last 2500 years. And the number of people who must have been killed in this period, according to Rammal, is 1.2 billion. And 99% of them have been killed by the West. The only country in which killing never took place till the 13th century is India. We did not know how to kill people. We did not even know how to kill animals. That is why 40% of the Indians remain vegetarians even today. I am not blaming the non-vegetarians. Most of the non-vegetarians will not eat the non-vegetarians if they have to kill and eat. You must understand that. Because we are a highly sensitized to society. We can never see blood. Raw blood you can never see even of the animals. So the West knew how to kill. Give you a small example. You must have known Nobel. You heard of the Nobel Prize, you know. How did Nobel endow that money? You know that? He created the dynamite, which could blow up people and kill people. China invented the dynamite 2500 years ago. And they decided not to use it for military purposes. The moment West invented the dynamite, it used it only for military purposes. This is what I say about killing. America invented the atom bomb. It threw it on Japan. It killed people. That kind of killing only Hitler can do, only England can do, only French can do, only Germans can do, only Americans can do. It's a demonstrated proposition because they are conquerors. Only a conqueror kills. I have spoken this in America. Don't think I am speaking here. He can't kill. So, when I say about world, it is the West-centric, West-driven, West-modeled, West-inspired world. And what is happening to that world? That world is seen as the developed world. But it is developing at the cost of its own soul, its own civilization, its own culture, its own society, its own DNA, its own economy. I will demonstrate it in the next 2-3 minutes and then leave the West for you to imagine what it is. You know, the West developed the idea of individualism. Individualism is supposed to be the chief element of modernity. I go back to modernity. When I say modernity, it is the modernity of individualism. The individual is supreme. The individual is supreme not only in the context of the state. Individual freedom, individual right, individual liberty. But the individual is supreme even to the family. The individual is more important than the family. This element came as the supreme value of modernity. That a son or a daughter need not bother about the parents. The parents need not bother about the son or the daughter. The brother need not bother about the sister. The sister need not bother about the brother. Nobody needs to bother about anybody. This is supposed to be individualism. This is almost an animal kingdom. You know what is the end result of it? The entire family architecture of the West has collapsed. Today in America, 41% of the babies born are born for unwed mothers. And half of them, school-going girls. They carry babies in their arms, put it in the creche, and attend classes. Father of the child, God alone knows. 41% of the children do not have the father's name. Those who are born, don't think England is better. 51% of the babies born in England are born for unwed mothers. 49% of the families do not have the father and the mother living together, or there is no father at all. In 1998, an American sociologist wrote a book, A Fatherless America is Emerging. You may say it is cultural degeneration. It is a spiritual degeneration. It is a social degeneration. It is not just that. It is an economic degeneration of a kind which no economic expert can reverse. Certain things you can reverse. Stock market falls, you can reverse. An industry goes down, tariff rates can be upped, it can be reversed. An industry goes into ruin for want of finance, you can give finance and reverse. But the kind of decline which I am going to talk to you about, it doesn't require knowledge of economics. You will, all of you will vote with me to say this kind of fall is irreversible. If you look at the American savings level in 1960, the share of family savings, at that time American families like were your family and my family. Modernity had not devastated America in 1960. It began doing it only in 1970. So at that time, the share of American families, total American savings was 80%. The share of corporates was 20%. Today, the share of corporates in American savings is 120%, and the American families have a negative savings of 20% because they have all been given credit cards to spend. So everybody spends without their income. And 30 crore Americans, out of which only 23 crores are economically active Americans, have 120 crore credit cards. The whole society is turned into a borrowing society. Nobody takes care of the parents. Nobody need to take care of the parents. If a child stays with the parent beyond the 16th year, they ask, are you shameless? You are living with us? Are you not supposed to be going outside and looking after yourself? This is a social norm. In the classroom, a child is asked, you are still staying with your parents? Social norms are destroyed. In just 50 years, it's over. You can destroy these norms, you cannot rebuild them. As a result of it, the entire responsibility to take care of the parents, the informed people, the unemployed people, has passed on to the government. This is called social security and health security. The government takes care of the people who cannot take care of themselves or who have nobody to take care of them. And you know what is the unfunded? Unfunded means you have the expenditure, you don't have even 1 rupee for that. That is what is called unfunded. The total commitment to future liability because of health and social security is measured today at $68 trillion. America's GDP is $18 trillion. $68 trillion is the unfunded liability against which America does not even have $1. The entire cultural collapse is leading to an economic collapse. How long a society can go on like this? Because society is weakened, culture is weakened, family is weakened, relationships are weakened. But in India, the family superstructure takes care of all these people. Tell me, in IIT Bombay, I asked this question in University of California, Los Angeles, to the management section. I asked the students there, about 70, 80 students were there. I asked them, how many of you are supported by your family to pursue higher education? Not a single boy out of the 70 lifted their hand, because no family would support higher education of the children. The same question I asked in IIT Bombay, where were 350 students were there. How many of you are supported by your family to pursue the education? The entire 350 people raised their hands. I am going to ask you this question. How many of you are being supported by your family to pursue the education here? You understand what it is? It is not culture alone, it is not spiritualism alone, it is not society alone. This is economics. Sharing of responsibilities in terms of money. So what happened? The entire families have been nationalized. All the family responsibilities are nationalized. Government is being privatized. Water supply, airport, roadways, which are supposed to be the responsibility of the government from the days of Ashoka. If you look at the history of Ashoka, Guptas, Chera Chola Pandyas, the only thing they were doing is build water supply, build roads, build forests. These are all public responsibilities of governments from time immemorial. Those things are being privatized. The responsibilities of parents, grandparents, brothers, sisters, sons, this is being nationalized. This is called modern economics. This is the output of modernity. My dear students, you are all like my children. I have son and daughter older than you. Modernity means sexual freedom, period. Nothing else. It will destroy women first. A research was done by two economic professors. This is available on the net. Women's happiness has decreased in 30 years. I forget the name of the two scholars. I can send it to you by mail. They said 30 years when women's freedom is supposed to have gone up, their satisfaction has come down. Man's satisfaction has gone up because they have got dominance over women. And women have got responsibility, men have no responsibility. With the result, women have been reduced to a position of dissatisfied people. This is the research done by Pennsylvania University professors, which is accepted by the Bureau of Economic Research, America. This is the output of modernity. Modernity destroys women, but it gives them clothes which they can wear and show themselves. Otherwise, it contributes nothing to women. This is the world we have to handle today. And the shelf life of many of these ideas today. We conceived of Advaita. 2000 years, it is still on. This is Advaita. Still on. These are all enduring thoughts. Thoughts which sustain the society. The Bhakti movement. Family responsibilities. Thousands of years before they have been instituted to discipline the family, put self-restraint on children, parents, that my self-restraint is your right, your self-restraint is my right, your duty is my right, my duty is your right, my right is your duty. This is how we balanced duties and responsibilities. And handed down from generation to generation, and the idea is dharma. So I had a discussion with a professor by name Kumar Bhattacharya. He has written books on management subject. Those who are management graduates may know that. He was also an advisor to the South African government, Malaysian government. He was the advisor to Margaret Thatcher when she had undertaken the Star Wars program. And in fact, in the Star Wars program, when they said it is an all-white meeting in which an Indian cannot be present, Margaret Thatcher insisted Kumar Bhattacharya must be present. That was the stature of the man. He came to India in 2001. I had a discussion with him. He said, no, no, Guru, you are not allowing, because I was fighting against privatization of railways, about airways and all that. He said, Guru, you must allow these things to be privatized. Why are you preventing all this? I asked him, why do you want these things privatized? Because they are a burden on the government. He said, certainly. Why should the government run railways, bus services? Why should it run BHEL and things like that? I told him, which is the biggest public's burden in the West? You say these are all, railway is a big public burden. By the way, how many people know that Indian railways transport the whole of Australia every day? Australian population is 3.2 crores. We transport 3.24 crores every day from one destination to the other. And these fools want it to be privatized. Only a government backed by law can run such a huge enterprise. Anyhow, that's a secondary thing. Because no one in the world has this big a railway at all, including China. So, I told him, I asked him which is the biggest public burden of the government in the West. He said the social security is the biggest public burden of the government in the West. I asked him, can you ever privatize it? We can always privatize BHEL. Anyone will give you 25,000 crores and take BHEL. If you want to privatize Air India, even today, there are people who will give 50,000 crores. Because these are assets. But if you want to privatize social security, which is a liability, can you ever privatize it? And you can never privatize it unless there is a family. You cannot create, you can create companies by law, you cannot create families by law. But you can destroy families by law. There is a law which has been passed today, 10 years back. Domestic Violence Act. It was acclaimed as the greatest liberator of the Indian women because they are being beaten at home. Now there is a law. You know who is the fellow who will come and do this? The local police inspector, half drunk, taken money from the husband, and he is supposed to do justice between the husband and wife. And this is supposed to be a progressive modern law. How idiotic can be the public discourse which accepts this? You know, we are such a family that even a neighbor will come and say, don't do this. I have seen near my house, no, I live by the side in a lower middle class locality. In spite of the rise in my status and all that, I never wanted to move out of the locality because my children are being brought up and shaped by that locality. If they are good children today, it is only half because of me, it is half because of the society. So when I used to come, if there are problems in a family, the neighbors will go and say, please don't behave like this, be normal. This is called social capital. The society intervenes, the elders intervene. In fact, you are all students of law. Is that right? Some are. Many of them. If all the disputes of India land in courts, the courts will run away. 99% of the disputes are resolved by the society. You must have heard about the Manipal group. It's a very big group. The matter went to High Court, could not be solved. It went to the Supreme Court, it could not be solved. They ordered an arbitration, it did not get solved. Then Dhirubhai Ambani became the arbitrator. You know, Dhirubhai Ambani, people not only respect, they fear. Of course, they used to. He gave an arbitration award that could not work. Then they all went to Dharmasthala. You must all go to Dharmasthala, the law students, and see how from the morning to the evening, Virendra Hegde sits and listens at least 300 disputes a day he resolves. He tells anyone, if you are telling the truth, you tell before Manjunatha Swami you are telling the truth. Then nobody will tell a lie. But you know, a witness is tutored to tell the lie in the court, because the court is not a sacred place. It's a secular place. Society is strong. Family is strong. For which the credit should go to the women of India. Men have done nothing. Why I am saying this? It is my mother who brought me up. My father died when I was 5. My mother used to make papad. I used to go and sell it in the market. My mother and me used to work till 2 o'clock in the morning. I was a child labor. I worked with her. I will go and sleep. She will get up at 5 o'clock in the morning. I wrote an article on her death in Dinamani. Reading this, at least 10,000 emails came. Many people cried reading that article. How a mother can become a saint? No man can become a saint. This is the gift India has to give to the world. It is the women of India who have preserved this. Even the DKDMK movement failed only because of the Tamil women. You know that? These people will always be, there is no God, burn God, and they will be going to temples. A DMK leader met me about 2 years back, before the last election. I told him, your ideology is over. Why are you doing all this? I gave him the reason also. There was a time when black shirt meant Periyar. Now black shirt means Ayyappa. The ground has shifted. So I said, this is over now. Why are you doing this? He said, sir, I may be doing this, but my wife is going to all temples, sir. I said, only because of your women, all of you have been saved. So women have preserved the culture of India, traditions of India, values of India, relationships of India. The relation-based society is the asset of India. The West is a contract-based society. Not only husband and wife relationship, any relationship is contract-based. In America, a son went to court about 6 months back. I want to pursue higher education. My father is not educating me. The American Supreme Court said, your father has no duty to educate you. If you want to get educated on your own. Can you believe this? And that society is a dying society, declining society. In terms of culture, in terms of sociology, in terms of politics, in terms of economy. And this is seen in the huge shift which is taking place in the economic power from the West to Asia. Those who are economic students will easily understand that more than 50% of the world GDP, there was a time when the West produced 70% of world's GDP. Today almost 60%, maybe 50%, maybe 51% of the GDP has shifted to Asia. There is a paradigm shift. It is not only an economic shift, it is a military shift. It is a geopolitical shift. It is a military shift. But do we understand all that? We are still in an enslaved state of mind. India is a rising power, it is going to be a global power, it is already becoming having all the characteristics of a global power. For example, let us see how we handle 2-3 issues. Pakistan was always threatening, they will hit you with the terror. But they will say, if you do anything, we have atom bomb with us. So we thought, these are mad fellows, they may drop an atom bomb on us. This is the fear, no? See, there is one thing which unites India, fear. But here is a prime minister who decided not to have fear. He said, come on, go and hit them in their place. We had these targeted raids. We are shaken. Because India decided not to fear, nothing else. Pakistan has the same atom bomb. They will never dare raise their hand with the bomb. They will be finished. Because if Pakistan throws one atom bomb on India, in the next 24 hours, there will be no Pakistan. This is the message we gave to Pakistan, openly. Now we can go and do this targeted raid anytime. Shift. Once you do that, the world also says, no, no, these people are terrorists. They were terrorists for the last 20 years. But the world has begun saying only today. You know why? Because you have decided to do things. You change, the world responds. Now take the Doklam crisis. How many people know the basics of Doklam crisis with China? Please lift your hand. 1, 2, 3, half hand. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Doklam crisis is a power shift as to what India is. You see, Doklam is in the tri-corner of India, China and Bhutan. Bhutan is an independent country. Sikkim is India's part. In this tri-junction it is there, it is about 18,000 feet high. And China has been laying roads in this area. Its own, Doklam is its own territory. It has been laying roads. China laying roads in its own territory, what can we do? So our governments used to write letters. Why? Because Doklam is in such high place. From there, they can see, like I can see, this small pathway, which is the Kuch Bihar area, a 27 kilometer territory which connects the main region of India with the northeastern India. Just 27 kilometers pathway. If they put some 100 guns on the Doklam and say, you hand over Arunachal tomorrow, otherwise I will cut you off from the northeast, what will India do? Their own territory. You can't do anything about it. So we kept on writing letters. And they will tear the letter and throw it away. We decided this time. We sent our army. Demolished all our road construction equipments. Through the 2,000 workers who were doing work. China did not know what to do. These are such a terrified fellows. We thought they could do nothing. They said, 1962, we will finish you. He kept quiet. Then they began doing war exercises. They began showing to the world, we are doing war exercises. Missiles are being launched. Air force is being positioned. Tanks are being moved. They had taken videos and distributed it to BBC, CNN, show it. It was being shown. Indian media says war is coming. Our people were terrified. But our government was not terrified. We were quietly moving our army to the respective positions. Not one word. The Deputy Foreign Affairs Minister of China said a war is coming. We never responded. China did not know what to do. Because if they entered one part of India, we will enter another part of China. This was our strategy. And we had decided that a war may last for about 8 to 9 days. Because no country can carry on a war for more than that unless they angle for a much bigger war. No country wants to have a war, much less China, which has a trade surplus with India. If China has a war with India, India will be a huge economic beneficiary and China will be at a huge economic loss. So they calculated all this and said, let us talk. That is how the talk took place. India has known how to use its power. In this I heard from the topmost person who came and addressed a meeting here, I don't want to mention the name. He told me China went and shopped to all the countries. India has come into our territory and hit us. Please support us. Nobody was willing to support. He told me, you know why? It is because of the soft power of India. Nobody thinks India is an aggressive country. Except your own intellectuals, your own media people, your own politicians, India is an intolerant country. You are certifying this, world is certifying you as a tolerant society. No one can humiliate India more than the English educated people of India. This is the confusion. So we have to outgrow this, because we are today you go to America, you talk about Milton, nobody is interested in it. You talk about Wordsworth, nobody is interested in it. They would like to know about your Thiruvalluvar. They would like to know about your Upanishads. You know nothing about it. You think learning Milton is more important. Even they have given up Milton. Why are you learning Milton? We need a paradigm shift. So to prepare for the world 4.0, we have to prepare ourselves, because we are emerging as the leader of the world. We have military power. We have geopolitical power. You have human power. You are an emerging technological power. But more than that, you are a philosophical power. 130 crore people of different religions, speaking 900 languages, eating different food, living in totally different topographies, click together as a country. I was in Japan in January 2016 in a meeting where the ASEAN nations representatives and me were on the stage. There the moderator will devise the questions based on the speaker. What will the audience would like to know about this speaker? That is a person from India, what they would like to hear from an Indian speaker. The moderator devises the questions and he asked me a question. Mr. Gurumurthy, India is a country of such diversity. How is it able to work with the democracy? I said, I am surprised by this question. Because democracy is needed only where there is diversity. If it is an all-Muslim society, where is the need for democracy? It is only to elect whether Abdul should be the president or Wahab should be the president. But we have 30 crore gods. We have millions of texts. We have millions of ways of worship. So we need democracy. We need democracy because we are a diverse society. We know how to live together. If you have no will or capacity or philosophy or desire to live together, democracy will never make you live together. Democracy will make you function together, will not give you the desire to live together. So I said, we are a democracy in sociology. I explained to him what it is. We can live with totally contradicting situations. Not tolerate, but respect the contradictions. So I said, you know Sita. They all know Sita more than we know, because Japanese have produced 13,000 Sanskrit scholars. India has only 5,000, you must understand. They have mastered Indology. Their investment in Indology library in Tokyo University is $2.5 billion. Your investment in Indology in all the universities put together is not even half of it. That is how they have studied India. So I told them, you look at Sita, she obeyed her husband. Because of that she was great. You look at Meera, who defied her husband. Because of this, she was great. A lady obeying the husband is great. A lady defying the husband is great. We will respect both. Take Rama. Rama obeyed his father. Because of that, he was great. Prahlada defied his father. Because of that, he was great. Take Lakshmana, who obeyed his brother. Because of that, he was great. Vibhishana defied his brother. Because of that, he was great. I said, we can have 180 degree logic. We have a 360 degrees vision. That is why we are able to click as a democracy. Then the whole audience stood up and clapped. And the moderator said, this answer will be remembered for a very long time in Tokyo. Why I am mentioning this, I am actually pleading. My generation is over. We have lived in a generation of an enslaved state of mind. We were all fighting against this enslavement by the media, by the English educated people, the government, the educational institutions. But you are free from all this because in a computer you have all the knowledge which all the universities cannot put together give. You must grow independent. Not independence means not independent from parents, elders, teachers. You must grow independent of the establishment thought which destroys your self-confidence. All the knowledge that is available. You have this Angus Madison research, you have this Paul Byrok research. I will tell you two more things. With that I close. There is a book written by Edward Pocock and the name of the book is India in Greece. This book was written in 1854. 1854 means how long? More than 160 years ago. In that book, Pocock says, everyone says Greek is the origin of the Western civilization, Greece. The Greco-Roman civilization was the mother of the Western civilization. But no one knows who are the forefathers of Greece, Greek people. No one knows from where the Greek language emerged, because Greek language doesn't have its own grammar. There cannot be a language without grammar. But Greek language has no grammar. Where did it emerge? How did its construction took place? So E. Pocock did the research. And he identified the name of the forefathers of Greece as Thalassakis. And he routed it to Falasa Desha. And he came to Bihar and said from Bihar people moved 2800 to 3000 years ago, and he traced the route by which they had gone and found that the rivers by which they had travelled had been named as Ganga. Wherever their travel had taken place, the Ramayana and Mahabharata traditions were there. And so he said, there are three things based on which he said the forefathers of Greeks were Indians. One, he said, the Greek language has commonality with Sanskrit. For example, Pather is Greek language for father. We say Pitr. Matar is the name for mother. It is Matru. Bratar is their name for brother. We say Bratru. Like that, the near and dear relationships, 1 to 9, based on all this, he came to the conclusion that Sanskrit is the mother of Greek language. And all the Greek mountains and rivers had names in Sanskrit. So he said, India is there only in Greece, and Greece is the mother civilization of the West. When the British were ruling here and this book came, the British all bought all the books and burnt it. Because if the British who are ruling here, their civilization was supplied by Indians. Who are these fellows to rule us? But one book escaped, and that book is available on the net. You can go and see the original of India in Greece on the net today, available free. This was 1854, and no Indian university has even made you aware such a book exists. Because if it exists, then you will begin respecting India. You should not respect India is the basis of our education system. The laboratory for those thoughts in Greece, the laboratory for Greco-Roman thoughts of Plato and Socrates existed only in India. That book has been published by Motilal Banarsi Das in India. I would like the Shastra universities to buy half a dozen copy and make it available for the students to read.
Already,
thank you. Already, thank you so much. Why I am mentioning this is that we know very little about India, and the world wants to know about India. They are doing research about India. We are not even studying those researches. So we have a huge responsibility, at least people of this age has a very heavy responsibility. And the world 4.0, its survival depends upon India 4.0. Thank you very much.
We'll just have little time to take maybe three questions, and let me see if I have more time, because usually I don't restrict the number of questions, but this time I didn't restrict on the main speech because I know that he has a flight to catch, and today by any standards we have seen him speaking at Shastra for the last 15 years. I think it was the collective spirit and passion that was bundled and delivered in the 2018 lecture. Personally, I have never heard him speak so possessed as he did today. So it went on, but still we will have time for questions. Anybody who has a question, please raise your hand. It has to be a brief question, no comments, observations, brief question. Yes, Dr. Pugrin, I'll also locate one. Dr. Pugrin, the two, anybody from the girls, so that I am not accused of being general. Okay, three.
Sir, you spoke about Western modernity. I have a doubt. Bharatiyar, he spoke about Pudumaipen, Madar Dhammai Edivu Seyyum Madamai Koduthuvom. So according to you, is Bharatiyar a product of Western modernity?
Anyone who spoke about women's independence is equal to a Westerner. That is our problem. See, there were certain issues connected with Indian women because of the invasions in India. For example, in the north, all women, Hindu women, cover their face. But that is supposed to be a sign of a woman having become a widow. Why they had to do that? Because of the danger that invaders posed, and there was no Indian state to protect women. When there is no state to protect women, the women lose their independence. Not only women, we lost independence in so many ways. So this visited upon the women. But the Pudumai Penna Bharatiyar is a cultured woman. Not a woman who will show her independence by almost half dressing. So freedom of a woman is equal to today how less a dress she wears. That is modern. It is my sexual freedom. That is what the feminist movement proclaims today. That is not Bharatiya's concept of Pudumai Pen. Bharatiya's concept of Pudumai Pen was Draupadi. Who could tell her husband, you are a coward, you are impotent, you know the war is over. Mahabharata war was over. But Yudhishthira was crying like this. No, 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 I have killed these people, my brothers, my cousins. Are you an idiot? You have killed your enemies. Now we have won, let us enjoy. You know who says this? Draupadi. It is Draupadi who is the symbol of independent woman in India and not Madonna.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Sai Prasad. My question to you is, according to you, who are the top five thinkers of India who can collectively contribute to world 4.0?
Who?
Who are top five thinkers in India who can collectively contribute to world 4.0?
Adi Shankara,
yeah.
Mahavira, Gautama Buddha, Ramanujacharya, Madhvacharya, Guru Nanak. These are sufficient. You don't need thinkers every day. One thinker can influence forever. We can't build modern thinkers today who can go beyond their lifetime. Today, in fact, I could not complete my lecture. Shelf life of most of the thoughts and systems is reducing. Colonialism lasted for 150 years. Over. Capitalism lasted for 100 years. Communism lasted for 60 years. Globalization lasted for 25 years. But Advaita, Vishishtadvaita, Dvaita, Buddhism, all these things continue. Non-conflicting. You can have a conquering religion ruling over the world by conversions and other things. All that I am mentioning is a non-converting religion. The Supreme Court, these religions are tolerant religions. Only a tolerant society is a durable society. So you don't need a role model every 15 years. In fact, the role models which come and go are to be rejected. Aurobindo Ashram mother said, we have to look from the past to the future. Because the present is confusing. Don't rely on the present day thinkers as role models because they are a confused lot.
Vanakkam sir, I would like to know your opinion of where you see India in the next 10 years. I want to know your view on the basis of social relationship aspect and economic development.
See, economic aspect, India will keep on rising because Indians are acquiring more and more desire to earn wealth. But the more important thing is how India is going to position itself to the world. There I am very, very confident. Many people think that there is so much of corruption, there is so much of wrongdoing. I'll give you an example about Tamil Nadu. Please sit. In the year 1967, 70, 71, it was the age of darkness in Tamil Nadu. In fact, when I was in school in Tamil Nadu, the Tamil teacher used to teach, Uve Swaminathayar Andhanarahi Irundhalum Nallavar. This used to be in the open classroom. And there used to be such venom against gods, against culture, against values. The political leader, the leading political leader of Tamil Nadu used to say, Matran Tottattu Malligai Manakku. I don't think anyone could have spoken in a lower language than this. And he became a celebrated leader. All the Hindu gods were painted naked and taken in a procession in Salem in 1972. And Cho Ramaswamy in the Tuglak magazine published this. No other paper had the courage to publish it.
Because of that, the government virtually banned the Tughlaq. People were afraid of going to temples, celebrating. People would wipe out their forehead when they were going in public. This was the situation when none of you might have been, maybe your parents were just born. In the Tamil Nadu today, wearing the same black shirt with which these people were creating all this confusion, 1.5 crore people go to Shabarimala. Complete shift. Likewise, those who are going to this Payani, Kavadi, it used to be an annual affair. Now it is every month. Why I am saying is, people are becoming more and more pious, more and more quiet, more and more spiritual. That is why in India you have only 12,800 police stations for 668,000 villages and towns. Nowhere in the world you have such small police force. And with that, India is a country which is one of the lowest crime reporting country in the world. Why I am mentioning this is going to be the social capital, the infrastructure on which the Indian prosperity will be built. But the Indians must know this. The most important thing is that you must know about all this. None of us know these things. So the challenge is not India's rise. The world must know, further the Indians must know, further the Indians must realize it is our family system, it is our relation-based living, it is our connectivity to one another, it is our spiritual foundation, non-conflicting, tolerant spiritual foundation which makes us work together so that the world respects you. The more the world respects you, in a situation like Doklam, your enemies will have no respect. Today, Pakistan has been given 3 months' notice. Behave yourself, otherwise we will take over the watching of all your banking transactions. How did it come? India's growing strength. This growing strength is not because of your university education or anything. It is because of the collective social strength of the people. That is why wherever go, I am pleading with them, please understand yourself, be yourself, behave yourself. That is, be an Indian. This is my request. Thank you.